Welcome to episode 105 of the Roger Snipes Show.
The Roger Snipes Show.
Many of us suffer from physical pain, some form of insomnia, mental health issues, or have problems with relaxing. All this can lead to chronic stress-related illnesses. That's why I use PEMF by NuMed. All their devices are medical grade and have double-blinded clinical studies to show its effectiveness. PEMF stands for Pulsed Electromagnetic Fields. Simply put, PEMF is a form of magnetic therapy using electromagnetic fields generated by copper coils. It targets the body at a cellular level, helping with a variety of disorders, diseases, conditions, and injuries through a wide range of applications. It actually helps with brainwave activity to assist with reducing mild depression and anxiety. If you suffer from sciatica, pelvic pain, rheumatoid arthritis, carpal tunnel syndrome, PEMF can help with that also. And lastly, if you want to reach peak performance and maximize your athletic ability, then yes, PEMF can help. Check out NuMed today at numed.co.uk and use coupon code SNIPES5 for 5% off. That website link again is numed.co.uk and use coupon code SNIPES5 for 5% off. Achieving your health peak has never been easier. Feeling stressed or want to feel more relaxed in a stressful situation? Well, Apollo Neuro helps your body recover from stress so you can sleep better, focus, and relax when you need it. It's a wearable device which you strap to your wrist like a watch, or you can wear it around your ankle. It works by something called touch therapy, sending your body soothing vibrations, speaking to your nervous system, telling you you are in a safe environment. Now, this has been developed by neuroscientists and physicians, and it's non-invasive. If you're about to go to a meeting and you're feeling a bit nervous, you can strap on the Neuro to prime you for the meeting. If you have finished a training session and you need your body to wind down and recover, the Apollo Neuro would come in very handy for that also. I personally let my six-year-old daughter use it just before she goes to school to prime her body for learning, and before bed in the evening as she winds down and gets ready for sleep. To get your hands on one of these Apollo Neuro devices, just visit Apollo Neuro, which is spelt OPOLLONEURO.com. ApolloNeuro.com and use code SNIPES10 for 10% off. It's time to get to know a more calmer, more mindful you. Yo, what's going on, peeps? Today's going to be a very interesting podcast because it's something which I think about on a regular basis as days go by. Every day I breathe, I think about it. Most decisions I make when it comes to food is linked to this very thing, and that is longevity. My guest today goes by the name of Sergey Young, who is a longevity investor. He is the founder of the 100 million Longevity Vision Fund, one of the few funds specializing exclusively in longevity and helping to accelerate longevity breakthroughs, which is pretty interesting. Now, I've had many people who discuss about longevity, but this one is very different. Part of Sergey's mission is to make longevity affordable and accessible to everyone, because as you know, a lot of the health and biohacking protocols today are not cheap. They're not cheap at all. Like, if you go to the shop and you want to buy good food, you have to pay a premium. You know that organic stuff doesn't come cheap. The grass-fed, grass-finished beef comes at a premium too. Things like NMN, which, again, another expensive price attached to it. So generic stuff is super cheap, but the things which you know is good for you is very expensive. And it's his mission to make it accessible to everyone, which is cool. Now, Sergey is the author of The Science and Technology of Growing Young. And this is what we spend a lot of our time dissecting. We cover things like centurions of the future. How do we create more? How do we create more centurions? Oh, sorry, centenarians. What is genetic engineering and what is genetic editing? And how can this be the future of health? We discuss a lot. We discuss a lot. And it could have stretched even further, but, you know, for the sake of the listeners, I had to cut it short. And I think he probably needed to get going as well. Now, when I read Sergey's book, I felt the general consensus of the book was breaking it down on how man and machine may become one someday. From wearables to implantables, if that's even a word, but let me just throw that in there. It's pretty wild stuff, but it really makes you think. It makes you question, where is our future heading? You know, we've seen lots of things happen over the years, lots of changes from, to simple cars to cars which are it's voice activated, you know, cars which don't need a key anymore. And now we have electrical cars. I'm sure we're going to have some sort of hovercrafts. Obviously, this is diverting slightly, but it's just to give you an idea on how advanced technology is and where it is going. I think this podcast is very exciting with lots of profound futuristic ideas. I hope you like it. Let's bring on Sergey Young. So, Sergey, how are you doing, my friend?
Hi, Roger. Hi, everyone. I'm super happy. It's Friday.
It's Friday. It's Friday. Yes, yes. What time is it where you are? And where are you, by the way?
Yeah, so I just made it back from London to Moscow, literally for 2 days, to take care of my mom. And I'm going to Boston over a weekend.
Okay. Wow, busy.
So it's 1 p.m.
Okay. All right. Nice. Nice. So it's 11, 12 minutes past 11 here in UK. And
yeah, so it's 12 minutes past 1 p.m. here in Moscow.
Cool. Is it cold there?
Not really.
Okay. Because that's all I hear about Moscow. You know, it's normally...
Yeah, look, like, world is so complex. We all need to have our own stereotypes. Well, this is survive, right, and succeed. Sometimes stereotyping is great. Sometimes it goes against the reality, but that's okay. It's still a pretty efficient way to discover and think about the world.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly, exactly. So talking about... how we envision the world. You've got a very broad mind, I must say. I came across your book, and this is one of the things that enticed me to reach out to you, because, like, I know
bits and pieces about longevity, and it's quite exciting for me to know about the basic stuff about, you know, taking care of yourself, eating well, perhaps a bit of understanding a little bit about ancestral living, the odd biohack. But what I see from your book is very, very different, very heavily outlines the possibility where human and machine could possibly live as one, making us, I don't know, some sort of cyborg or symbiote. It's profound stuff. How did you come to put piece this book together? It's amazing. I don't even know where to start. So you mentioned in the start of your journey, you're a chemical engineer. Is that right?
Yes. So chemical engineering is the first degree. Then banking and finance is the second one. I also done business administration, but for the last 20 years, I've just been investing into the space.
Mm-hmm. Right. So it's kind of, you fell into it by accident, I understand.
Well, let's discuss this a little bit, Roger. So like the story of so many people whom I know who started to develop their own interest in health and longevity started with a personal crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, your story is a story, you know, how you develop yourself through the, you know, personal crisis on so many dimensions. So do mine, right? I came from very small city in the far, far east of Russia. It was closer to Japan across the sea rather than to regional center. This is how far it was. And, but like fast forward, to when I was 43, I'm 49 today. The whole story of, 49, yes.
Oh my God, yeah. Wow, I thought we was roughly about the same age. Okay.
How old are you, Roger?
I'm 42.
Oh, really? Okay, so when I was 43, I went to doctor and his question was like, well, Sergey, when was the last time you've done a blood test? And I was like, well, it was a few years ago. I was so busy with my career, taking care of my parents, of my family, et cetera. And so I've discovered I have very high cholesterol level. Well, later on, I discovered I'm just genetically predisposed to have high cholesterol level. But the choice was, he said, well, Sergey, you need to take these drugs. And I said, this is great. That's okay. Is it for just 1 month? And he said, no. This is a special class of drugs. They lower your cholesterol. You would need to take them like every day for the rest of your life. And I was like, oh my God. And I was not really keen to do something like just to live on medication for another 40 years until I die. At this time, I thought I'm going to be living just another 40 years. Not now. Now I'm more optimistic. So, and I said like, tell me what is the alternative? And he said, well, everyone knows what to do. Like, you know, physical activity, changing your diet, supplementation, and that's it. And you're going to achieve almost the same result. And I was really shocked. I couldn't really believe my ears that this is just simple number of steps that I can take can actually replace medication. So I started to experiment with my health. In the course of 6 months, I decreased my cholesterol level. I've done a lot of changes in my diet. I was swimming like every day in a swimming pool. And I felt so energized, so changed.
Right.
And I thought, okay, if I can do it, so many people can do it as well. So I started to like push all of my friends to do the same. And this is where one of the things that which are important today for our health is, in addition to all these lifestyle changes, on the dimensions that you know, like diet, physical activity, mindfulness, meditation, etc., is just early diagnostic. So like just making sure like every at least every year you do a comprehensive medical checkup medical screening is super important. And so my story, like, it's all started with my personal health crisis, where I developed the interest into like health and longevity and lifestyle changes. Then I pushed a lot of people to do their medical screening. Some of them discovered early stage cancer, but because it was early stage, they fully recovered, right? So right now we're living in a world where early stage cancer, if this is, if you discover this early stage, your recovery rates can be up to 90 or even 100%. And the quality of your life is still gonna be the same. So they called me back and they're like, Sergey, you saved my life.
Wow.
And I felt so great. You know, I thought, okay, well, this is my purpose. God didn't give me the passion before I turned 43. So I thought, okay, well, I can do it like for the rest of my life. How I can support this whole space, how I can help people to be healthier and happier version of themselves. So I set up the fund because I've been investing for last 20 years all over the place. And I thought, okay, I'll just do the relatively small fund to support scientists and entrepreneurs who are working on development of different health and longevity technologies. Well, here we are. It's already fourth year of operation of Longevity Vision Fund. We invested in 18 companies. But what is more important, every year we're looking at 200 companies. And this is really unique. Like no one in the world is looking at this field, you know, on everyday basis. And I met so many great scientists, so many great entrepreneurs. I find so many breakthroughs that are now in development in terms of life extension and health span extension. So I thought I just need to share it in a book. So it was 3 years journey, 50 interviews, again, number of like hundreds of companies that we look at. And I compile a book about different horizons. There is something you can do today, combination of lifestyle and early diagnostic and a little bit of wearables. Yeah. So this will give you an opportunity to live to at least 100 healthy and happy years, unless you're genetically unlucky. And let's discuss today the role of genetics.
Yeah.
For our health and longevity. Like we all can live 200 to 100 years. And that's important. But again, then 5, 10, 15 years from now, there's something what I call the near horizon of longevity innovations. So, and these are all technologies which will be widely available within this time frame. And I'm talking about gene editing and gene therapy, organ regeneration, our ability to replace organs inside our body, and longevity in appeal. Like some of the things that you know, like metformin, rapamycin, or it can be, we still need to test the substances in terms of longevity effect, but it can easily be drug developed by artificial intelligence, yeah, in 10 years from now. And then again, so this will help us to break the sound barrier of 122 years, to break the maximum lifespan that we've seen on Earth.
What's the current average lifespan on Earth, would you say?
Yeah, I think it's somewhere between 75 and 80 years.
Right, and what would you say is some of the science which you're working on to ensure more centenarians of the future?
That's a great question. So what we've done in the last 100 years, we increased the average lifespan on Earth from 35, 40 years to 75, 80 years. So we already doubled our average lifespan. And this is great. Like this is thanks to just a lot of people and a lot of inventions, technology, sanitation, science, medical advancements as well. So, well, this is great. While we were increasing the average lifespan, the maximum lifespan always stayed the same. It was always somewhere around 120 years. So it seemed to me that we have this genetic kind of clocks inside our body, which would, you know, make sure your body will not survive outside 120 years. So we do have more centenarians on Earth every year. Yeah. So the number of them is growing at really high pace. But I do think centenarians are important examples for us about the importance of genetics, right? So like my very good friend, professor from New York, Nir Barzilai, who is actually organizing the study to test metformin as a longevity drug, not as diabetes drug, but longevity drug,
right.
Together with American Federation of Aging Research. He's done a study of centenarians, and he actually found out that in 60 to 70% of cases, the fact that they are centenarians and they were living longer, it's due certain genetic structure, genetic choice, genetic makeup that they have within their DNA. So we already know all 3,000 genes which are responsible for our longevity and healthy living. All we need is to have the technology to influence that and have regulation and human ethics approving that. Yeah, this is very important as well.
Are you suggesting that some sort of regulation that we can give others that type of genetics through?
Yeah, so basically what is happening, again, like what we can do today is just early diagnostic and lifestyle, okay? But a lot of things are coming on the horizon, and some of them is our ability to change our genetic setup. It's called genomic medicine, it's gene editing, and you probably heard about CRISPR. This is basically your genetic scissors. Mm-hmm. And in addition to CRISPR, we have a number of different technologies in gene editing space. Some of them, they really can cut portion of DNA and replace it with other genes. Some of them just help switch on, switch off our genes, right?
And what's the benefit of switch on and switch off? Is that for like to prevent cancer and stuff? Or?
Yeah, like sometimes you don't need to take like a gene from your DNA, right? You just want to make sure that it doesn't really manifest itself in the body, just by different scientific means. That's basically it. And then, so think about this, like what are the ways that we can use gene editing for our benefits? Right. Number one, we can influence child's health. Right. Some of the people were born with rare genetic diseases. And there's this a category of diseases which is used for regulation to speed up the approval of the drugs and medical interventions called rare diseases. While we call them rare, they're not that rare. There are 400 million people on Earth suffering from that. Right. So like number one, we can, basically, modify the DNA either on the parent level or during the pregnancy or upon birth to help kids not to suffer from genetic diseases. So that's kind of one. Right. This is on infant level. We can help people who are suffering or like adults who are suffering from that. On genetic level, we can also influence our age related diseases, whether it's diabetes, cancer, heart disease, neurodegenerative diseases as well. So that's the opportunity as well.
Did you say that's age related?
So 90% of deaths after age of 50 are happening what we call due to age related diseases. And therefore, as I call them, killer monster diseases, cancer, heart disease, diabetes, and neurodegenerative diseases like dementia.
Yeah.
Okay. 90% of that, and this is why aging is bad in terms of our health. With the like when aging process starts inside your body, usually anywhere between 40 and 45 years. There's many theories when aging starts, and in some of the like academic groups, people think the aging starts from your day one on the planet. Nevertheless, like the aging starts, like massively starts somewhere around 40 or 45 years when we've done with our reproductive agenda on Earth and we took care of the next generation. Mm-hmm. So they reach the reproductive age. So that's how Mother Nature constructed that, right? And this is why aging starts. So starting from when we start to age, like 40 or 45 years old, the probability of you getting this age-related disease, cancer, heart disease, diabetes, neurodegenerative disease, increase exponentially year by year. Mm. So we can use gene editing and gene therapy to fight that. Then what else? If we know all 3,000 genes, which are working properly in centenarians and are responsible for our longevity, and even for aging inside our body, we can influence these genes, right? So for example, like in the long-term future, you will be able to pick up your target age, whether you want to live in the 25 years old body and mine, or 35 or 40, like it's really up to you. We can reverse aging on genetic level. You know, obviously this is just, right now we are in the beginning of getting scientific discoveries and technological breakthroughs in this area. But, you know, time flies really fast. So who knows, like in 10, 20 years from now, it might easily be available. And it is available today, like gene therapy.
Yeah.
So mRNA vaccine and like Moderna and, you know, some other vaccines, COVID vaccines, are the outcome. They've been developed with the use of gene therapy.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is amazing. Yeah,
it is. It's totally incredible. I mean, we are on the beginning of that with many of the biohacks which we have to, I guess, help to deal with like DNA damage, which we might have. And I don't know, things like, what have we got? We've got oxygen hyperbaric therapy, yeah. Red light, yeah. And cryotherapy, yeah. And yeah. Stem cell treatments. And there's loads. But what I find is, a lot of the things which can help for longevity, including some supplements like NMN, they come at a price, yeah. Which not everybody can afford. Oh, there we go. for those who are listening to this and not watching the video, Sergey just showed his NMN. What brand is that? I might have to check that out.
It's actually, yeah, it's Alive by Nature. I ordered this in the US. What I like about this whole thing is it's sublingual.
Okay.
So it's dissolves inside your mouth. I do believe this. It's associated with high absorption rates. Mm-hmm. So that's why I kind of like it. It's just like, you know, 4 pieces I take every morning. It's kind of cool.
Awesome. Is that what keeps your youthful face? Can't believe it. You said 49. I was like, no way. I thought it was like, the only difference is, okay, maybe your hair shows a bit more as gray, but I shave my head, but I do have a lot of gray.
I think the beauty of being in the world of longevity, or whether it's longevity investing or biohacking or health, you need to look like a young person. You know, otherwise, like, who would believe you're actually working on longevity investments or longevity technology? So that's a positive side effect of my profession and my passion.
Yes. So with all this great stuff which you do and a lot of the, let's say, biohacks that are available, you know, I'm pretty blessed that I can use a lot of this stuff. However, many can't afford it. You know, some of the treatments that you speak of for the future, will that be mainly for those who are in a financially better position, or would that be available for others?
Yeah, so my mission and the mission of our fund is to bring affordable and accessible version of longevity to the world, right? I'm not interested to develop something which then would be like offered at $1 million a treatment, and will help only a handful of people on the planet. So how do we do that? First of all, we invest a lot in prevention. And prevention is 10, 20 times cheaper rather than responding. It's okay.
Sorry about that.
No, it's okay. So let me just start from affordability and accessibility aspect, right? So my mission and mission of Longevity Vision Fund is to work and deliver affordable and accessible version of longevity to the world and digital health. So how do we do that? Well, first of all, it is about prevention. So preventing something is 10, 20 times cheaper.
Wow.
Then responding to the disease when it manifests itself already in a big way. So that's already just huge efficiency gain. that you have. And then, well, that's why I'm delighted to report to all of you that almost every technology or intervention that we're investing in through Longevity Vision Fund, the efficiency gain from it is improvement by 10, 20, 50, not percent times against the current practice. And that's amazing. Whether we're talking about early cancer diagnostic company like Freenome, which use our blood test to identify with the help of artificial intelligence to identify whether we have a risk or early stage colon cancer, or it's affordable ultrasound devices, which cost 50 times less than ultrasound device in the hospital next door, 50. Or it's liver regeneration technology, where we use certain, when like company called like Genesis that we invested, they're based in Pittsburgh, then they take donor liver, they split it in 50 to 75 pieces. They put it in the lymph node inside human body. And then in the course of 3 to 6 months, the body kind of helps to grow another liver inside human body, and which supports the function of the liver, which is currently not working properly. So that's, again, it's going to be at least 10, 20 times cheaper than typical liver transplantation surgery. Like in US, as far as I recall, it's $800,000 for liver transplantation. Just a lot. And people wait for donor organs. There are 117,000 people in US only on a waiting list for donor transportation.
What sort of people can afford? How much you say? 800,000?
Yeah. It's just
like, how'd you really come up with that number?
Yeah. It's so therefore, everything we invest in should have a capacity and ability to like democratize this part of medical intervention or practice, etc. So I do believe that we're moving from very kind of old style, conservative, very reactive, like symptomatic driven version of medicine to the new version of medicine, which is preventive. Prevention is cheaper. And actually, well, the other good news about prevention is like the quality of your life is sustained. You're not going through something radical and lose the quality of your life. So which is preventive, personalized. We, data and variables and the current state of development of technology give us a huge opportunity to personalize this medicine. It's data driven, it's technology based. And this is what will make healthcare much, much cheaper and more and more efficient. And this is what we're going to see in the next 5, 10, 15 years.
A lot. Much better diagnostics than what is currently happening. You'd mentioned in your book about something called CAR T cell therapy. Is that right? CAR T cell therapy?
Yeah.
Is that something that is happening right now? Because this was totally new to me.
So obviously there are a number of technologies which are currently in development, and all of them are part of genomic medicine. So like people talk about CRISPR, this genetic scissors, but
you've seen a movie about them.
Yeah, really? Yeah. Yes. So like, but as we discussed, there are a number of technologies are in development, which will give us the same, like the opportunity to have the same impact, right? You can switch off some of the genes, or you can basically take like immune cells from the patients and genetically engineer them and put it back to the patient. And then, so then he or she has much more improved ability to fight cancer. This is how CAR T therapy works, right?
That sounds incredible.
Yeah, it is. Like, but I do think what is important is to understand in all of this coming, all of this will be widely available in the next 5, 10, 15 years. And it's our job today to stay on longevity bridge, to make sure we are in a healthy and happy state then in 10 years time, when you know, all of this will be available, our body and our mind is actually worth extending its resource.
Yeah,
that's our job. And like people think, okay, well, that's great. Sergey promised it's going to be different in 10, 20 years from now. I'll just sit and wait. You should not take care. Well, it's time to take back control and responsibility for our own health.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of people, it's like a lot of people right now is relying on almost like a vaccination to help improve their health. It's like, okay, it might help to prevent you having, how can I put it? A severe case.
Yeah.
But you still have a responsibility of taking care of your body, like strengthening your immune system, you know?
I agree. Like we delegated all our health choices to other parties and to other people.
Mm-hmm.
This is just amazing. Like it's always amazed me, like, you know, big food, big pharma, government, hospitals, insurance companies. And we're like, where is our voice here? Yeah. I mean, I'm not suggesting you need to make your own kind of diagnostic and prescribe yourself, you know, the medication, but like, you just need to be knowledgeable and curious enough just to like dig into that. And in some of the cases, there are so many changes that you can make on lifestyle basis, like eating healthy food, doing physical exercise, you know, meditating, sleeping well. It's really amazing way to manage your health, right? And with help of, you know, from a healthcare system, like in terms of medical screening, health screening on a regular basis. Well, this is great setup. You don't need to wait for another, you know, 5, 10, 15 years.
I think that is not something that is, how do I put it? It's not something that is, I don't know, you don't get a letter from your doctor saying, you know, you're due a checkup. You get it from your dentist.
Yeah,
you know, for repeat business. Yeah, you haven't been here for, or maybe your eyes. Yeah, need, you know, little checkup on your eyes, make sure that you're not blind. But I don't get any letter from my doctor to say, hey, come in, we need to check and make sure that everything's okay. People tend to go in the moment, you know.
I agree. And things are changing, right? Right now, I think it's our obligation to kind of see doctors and to say, guys, like we are, what I can do to check and prevent cancer, heart disease, diabetes.
Yeah, absolutely. What you mentioned in your book about the some myths of longevity?
Yeah.
Do you remember them? There was like three myths or something.
Yeah. Number of like misconception, if I can use this word, that we have about longevity. So one is living longer. It means like spending more time in the old age. So people think when I talk about life extension, like lifespan extension or health span extension, people think that we're going to get another like 10 years in the end of their life when they are in a very fragile state and need a lot of support, when they are becoming a liability, not an asset for the family, for community, for society. And this is bad. That it's not the case. We're working on extending the healthy and happy portion of human life. So that's kind of important as well. Second, people have always concerned if Mother Earth will be able to handle, you know, all this, you know, population on Earth. We have almost 8 billion people on the planet today. So what if everyone will be living longer? Like what will happen with world population? Will we have enough food, enough energy, enough space to accommodate all these people? And this is a very interesting question. So like, I'm not concerned about energy because renewable energy resources fundamentally changed the landscape of energy market. I'm not concerned about food because like 45% of food, it goes to waste, at least in the US, every night from supermarkets, restaurants, and from households. 45%. Imagine like how many people we can actually, you know, support with this food. So that's just a lot of inefficiency that we need to fix in terms of food distribution system, right? What else? And in terms of overpopulation, with exception of African continent, all over the world, we have extremely low reproduction rate. Like for average couple or for average female, the reproduction rate is 1.3, 1.5. While this is kids per family or per couple or per female. So like it needs to be at least 2.1. So that what will happen, if you look at the studies, what will happen? Population of Earth will continue to grow by 2050. And by 2050, it will peak at anywhere between 10 and 11 billion people. And then after that, it will decline down to 8 billion again. Like China will lose 600 million people if they will not respond to this demographic challenge, from 1.4 billion to 800 million. And same will happen everywhere, again, with exception of some African countries where reproductive rates are still pretty high. So it's not like we need to sit on the planet and the population will increase all the time. We would need to respond to this in demographic terms, and longevity and healthy longevity is the way to respond to that. That's important as well. And the third one, myth number three is that life extension is impossible. And obviously I couldn't walk you today through the whole book, but you'll see that a number of technologies which would just fundamentally change our ability to manage our health, manage our age and longevity as well. Again, we know 3,000 genes which are responsible for longer living and healthier living. We can influence them. And like 20, 30 years ago, gene editing was available only to a handful of people. And they had nothing to lose on this planet. They were genetically severely ill. So right now, I look at like Moderna. I was just reading the article about development of Moderna vaccine. And it starts with Moderna vaccine has been developed in the course of 2 days. Can you imagine that? Well, they obviously put a lot of work, like decade of hard work, to make it possible. But like in the end of the day, once we sequence genome of the virus of COVID, they've been able to develop vaccine that fast. And so that's what's gonna happen. Or think about old car. Like, what is the way for us to extend the resource of the old car? We're replacing parts. You can even replace an engine there. So what is happening? Like, and the same thing will apply to human body. We will be able to replace our organs. And you know, all of these technologies that I explained today, like this liver regeneration technologies, when we use our lymph nodes to regrow liver, and by the way, help 50 to 75 patients, not one from one donor liver, or 3D bioprinting of organs, it's gonna be just another way to, or another technology for us to extend our healthy lifespan. And I can go on and on. Like, you know, every decade in terms of the forecast and vision for the future will bring us different technologies, like human brain AI integration or brain computer integration. What is done by Elon Musk today in a company called Neuralink. This is amazing. We can help a lot of people with dementia to enjoy their last years on Earth.
Yeah. So do you see dementia as a thing of being the past, a thing of the past where we'll be sitting down like...
No. So remember these three, like four killer monsters that I explained, like cancer, heart disease, diabetes, and neurodegenerative diseases. So we've been dealing with cancer, heart disease, and even diabetes for some time because like, you know, peak in terms of like cancer or heart disease, the peak is anywhere between like 55, 65, and probably 75 years. So that's the length of your life when you face this kind of problem, this barrier. Mm-hmm. Neurodegenerative disease usually comes at later stage. Yeah, when you go towards your 80s or 90s. And this is pretty unique. We haven't had a lot of people in this age category on Earth for some time, until recently. That's why there were no signs, right? There were no technology working on solving neurodegenerative diseases. Like, if you compare it to like fighting cancer or fighting heart disease or strokes, right? So we're just in the beginning of understanding, like, what kind of disease is that? Like, where it starts, how we can prevent this, how we can treat this as well. So we don't know what we don't know about neurodegenerative disease. And this is one of the biggest challenges for quite a few decades going forward.
Okay. What's your thoughts on genetically modified food? I mean, many people talk about regenerative agricultural farming. However, it seems as though you, I guess, maybe glorify the idea of GMOs. Give me your thoughts.
So look, this is not my area of expertise.
Okay.
But what I can tell you is the whole food system need to be rethought and redesigned. And it always start with like, do we need to consume as much meat and fish that we consume today? Our diet, like through the whole history of evolution, our diet was not so rich in terms of the animal protein, right? I'm not vegetarian, I'm not vegan, but I decreased consumption of meat and fish quite substantially in the last 5 years of my life. So I'm like heavily plant-based. And one of the drivers for us of changing the food system and becoming healthier is integrating more plant-based food in our diet. So that automatically means that we'll have less focus on producing industrial meat and fish. Like, two-thirds of the crops that we produce today, they're not for humans. They are for, you know, animals. Like, why would we need so many animals on that if we structurally can change our diet to the healthier balance between animal protein and whatever we can derive from plants? So, like, when people tell me, like, well, Sergey, what if I couldn't really afford, you know, all of these beautiful changes, like, you know, supplements, like, or medical screening as well? And I actually drew my aspiration from Adrian Gore, the man who founded Vitality and Vitality UK. And he's from South Africa. Like, they've been developing their system of helping people to live healthier in South Africa, where like people had been in very poor conditions. And I had no access of resources to invest in their health. Like, he was telling me for my book, like, Sergey, like, the only option that we had available is just to help people live healthy, help people live healthier version of their life. That's it. So yeah, like, there's so many things that you can do today in this regards, and enriching your diet with and heavily focusing on vegetables was like one of the best biohacking hacks that I can give to people. Like, vegetables are cheaper, then they are more kind of useful and friendly to our body. And vegetables, they don't require antibiotics, growth hormones, and E. coli bacteria, like things which are now in our meat and industrial fish. So that's important.
Quickly, I mean, there's so many different viewpoints on that, you know. It can be a very long debate, and sometimes I'm like, do you know what, I wish I didn't have to eat. Like, it's just, there's too much information out there. I'm like, I don't like any of it. So there's those who say if you eat grass-fed meat, then, you know, you don't need to have a concern of any hormones or, you know,
antibiotics.
Antibiotics as well. And then, you know, you have some people who are very anti-plants. And they're like, you know, plants have their own toxins in them.
Yeah.
And we shouldn't be eating them. There's some which have, there's oxalates, there's, you know, lectins, and there's a whole range of plant poisons.
Yeah.
And some people believe we should just eat animals because the animals consume it and we can consume it through the animals and that sort of thing. But it's trying to find that middle ground. What works for you? It's so tough. And even when you talk of plants, unless you eat organic, then it's going to be sprayed with glyphosate.
Yeah, you're right.
So you're faced with another issue there. And you can't just wash off glyphosate, I've been told, you know? So it's like...
Yeah, that's true. Like, it's become pretty confusing. But, like, I think with plants, it's definitely less damaging for our body. Like, current industrial practices for producing the plants or vegetables, they're less dangerous for human body than what is done today in some of the developed nations in terms of industrial meat. Like, 70% of antibiotics in the US are consumed by animals like fish and animals on the farms, not by humans, right? So that's a huge issue.
One of my goals is to sleep like a baby and feel like a champion during the day. One of the hacks that I have to do this is red light therapy. Now, red light therapy is amazing. It helps with muscle size, strength, endurance, speed, cognitive ability, soreness, reduce fatigue, muscle recovery, increase range of motion in the joints, knee pain, rheumatoid arthritis, increase melatonin, boost production of endogenous anti-inflammatories, increase energy, boost collagen, and that's not even the end of it. I use the Advantage 1500 by Red Light Rising, and I feel like a superhero on a mission during the day and a bear on hibernation in the evening. If you're looking to boost your overall health, then get yourself a Red Light Therapy panel by visiting www.redlightrising.co.uk and use code SNIPES for 5% off.
But I agree with you. I mean, it's very difficult to find the kind of right balance there. But what I know is it should be a balance, right? You couldn't really like eliminate some of the things and just leave on one other thing. Like, you know, fat is bad, animal protein is bad, plants are bad. So like it's just mutually contradicting, you know, all the time.
Always. What can you tell us about resveratrol? I've heard that it's very beneficial for those who are looking for longevity. I've also heard lots of people say they have red wine because it's rich in resveratrol.
Yeah. So,
please.
Yeah, so, resveratrol is a substance that we have in Mother Nature, and especially in some of the grape types like Pinot Noir, and it's believed to be, and this is one of the hypotheses that we had in the science, is to mimic the effect of caloric restriction. So there's a lot of disagreement in academic community and in society what actually extends your lifespan and health span. But there's one agreement, like decreasing your caloric intake, like consuming 15 to 25% less calories a day, would actually add another 2, 3, 5 years to your life. So, and for many years, scientists has been watching and looking for the substance which will help you not to kind of do fasting or like decrease your food intake, but like, what if we can find the chemical, hopefully from Mother Nature, which will help us to like mimic this, you know, caloric restriction. So it has been found in wine. And what I can say, I haven't seen a lot of studies confirming the positive effect of it. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's one. Second, like, if you would like to receive resveratrol through consumption of red wine, I have this figure in the book. I think it's at least 3 or 4 liters of wine that you would need to like drink every evening during the day. It's just a lot, okay?
Yeah.
So like, and it's like, and after like one or maximum like 2 glasses of wine per occasion, not every day, it start to work against you, right? It's alcohol, it's a poison, right? A little bit of the poison can make you stronger, can generate, can provide this kind of small shock, your body to respond and become stronger. But like after 1 or 2 glasses of red wine, it's literally going against you in terms of your health trajectory. So like, it's just really impossible to like get it with a wine in statistical terms. So, and I haven't found a lot of evidence of resveratrol really helping or making significant or meaningful effect on our longevity. Having said that, Roger, I must admit, I here in my office, I have a number of supplements for October, for my October rotation, and resveratrol are there.
Right.
Yeah. So what I do, like, I'm like 30 or 40% of the supplements effect is placebo effect. This is very typical. If you believe it works, then it works for your body.
Mm.
Okay. So your body responds to like power of your thoughts and your belief. So that's why like every 6 months I'm still taking resveratrol and I'm typical placebo man.
No.
Yeah, I if I believe in something, it actually happened. That's why my motto, like every morning when I wake up, I'm telling myself, Sergey, you're going to live 200 years in the body of 25 years old man. Nice. And imagine it's produced a lot of interesting results. First of all, you're just becoming younger in terms of the energy, the way you look, the way you dream, the way you work. And it's kind of cool. Like every morning, like 3/4 of my life is ahead of me. I know it's completely irresponsible promise. And there's no technology today to help you live outside 120 years. But it's okay. I can believe in my own stuff, right? It's not harmful for anyone. So I do believe that, well, it's just a lot of mixed views on supplements. What I know is... part of the critiques on supplements are derived from the fact that many of them are from Mother Nature and no one can really patent that. Right. So no one will benefit from testing like milk thistle in effect of it on your liver or like lowering cholesterol level, right? And that's why just a lot of critique of supplements, like no one is really interested to... do like a lot of scientific research on that. I know that. So that's one. Second thing, I do believe that number of substances are and supplements are working, like vitamin D supplementation, omega-3. You can find a lot of studies for that. And again, and number three is I told you, like if you are a placebo man or woman, welcome to my world. Just believe it works and it will work.
You know, that's how I started off with the whole weight training, because when you're young and then it was before internet was here, looking at magazines of these bodybuilders, they say, use this protein and you'll look like me. And I was like, wow, that's all I need. Why isn't other people having this?
Yeah. Oh,
I found the secret. So I'd save up my pocket money and buy it and be training and looking in the mirror like, I don't seem to be changing. I must be doing it wrong. Yeah, I'm not training right. That's what it is. But I'm going to get there. You know, that strong belief, working, yeah, working, 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 until it just got to the point where I'd invested so much time that I just continued with my fitness journey, which was kind of cool. And some people say that that is an issue, and you know, this, you know, giving people the false idea that it's going to work is not good. But actually, as long as you believe it, you know, you're still getting the result anyway. You know, so I think
looking at you, I mean, it works, Roger.
Yeah.
This is one of the myths as well. Like, people always ask me, like, Sergey, what is like one thing that I need to do? And my answer is always like, there's no such a thing like one thing. So if one solution to like aging or to beauty or health would exist, then Mother Nature would have been found this in the process of evolution, or our brilliant scientific minds would find the like fountain of youth, right? Or one single solution. So it's always combination of things, always. And whatever horizon that we discuss today and I discuss in the book, you look at like today, 10 years from now, like 50 years from now, it's not going to be one thing. And that's the beauty, but that's the downside of that.
Yeah. Talking of that, certain things which you speak of is just wild. Like, I mean, I think there's a section where you talk about the possibilities of like nanobots in your bloodstream, identifying injuries, and making repairs, and that would like deliver nutrients to certain parts of your body and vitamins and medicine via microchip embedded into your body. That's wild.
Like, this is happening today. So, well, this is very interesting. What I call in the book is far horizon of longevity innovation. So this will be available to us in the next 25, 50 years. And before we'll discuss technologies, I just want to say that the ethics of that is really important. That's why the last chapter of the book called Morality of Immortality, like there's so many ethical things that we need to change in this world to embrace the idea of like man and machine integrating, to embrace the idea of longer living. Okay, so that's ethics are important. We'll discuss that, or you can download this chapter from my website. So technologies, like how the world will look like in 50 years from now, I'm pretty sure we will redefine humans. Okay, we are like just you and I are here today, and we tend to overestimate our importance and our excellence in evolutionary terms. In the process of evolution. But like in 25, 50 years from now, humans will be different. That's for sure. I mean, it's kind of bad news. It hasn't started with our generation, but that's okay. You know, people were living here for so many, you know, centuries, you know, thousands of years, like millions of years, right? Human race. So what's going to happen is gene editing, gene modification of humans. We can influence our longevity genes. We can influence a lot of other genes to protect ourselves from these killer monsters, right? So like number of your age will not really define your state of health in the future, right? It's going to derive from a lot of different things, your own decision, like your target age, how many decades you want to live. Are you enjoying your life on earth, right? Do you have a purpose in life, etc.? So that's one thing. Second thing, we obviously going to be integrated with computer. Like we already integrated with computer, right? So but like our smartphone, and this is what I'm holding in my hand, but I'm just using very inefficient interface for this integration. So I'm using my eyes, my ears, I'm using my fingers to type something there. Well, like it's going to be much more seamless, right? And this is what is done by Elon Musk today in Neuralink, human brain computer integration. And again, if you're fearful of technology, think about people on Earth today, which would benefit from it. So when I have my fears about brain computer interface, I'm always thinking about people who are suffering from dementia.
Yeah.
We can help them with that. It's beautiful. So then what else? Internet of bodies, right? Like you've heard the concept Internet of Things, where just a lot of things inside around us are interconnected, right? Through like internet, they have sensors, they can exchange the information. The same thing will happen with human bodies. We're all going to be full of sensors, and you know these sensors will, you know, exchange the information between themselves or with centralized AI run system, which will help us to monitor and manage our health. And it's coming. Like I'm full of sensors today, right? You can see, you know, I wear the Oura Ring, Whoop, Apple Watch, continuous glucose monitor. This is just the beginning, right? This is beautiful. Like every day I can have a feedback on like, what is the level of my health or what are the risks? Like what can be done by variables today? It's like a miracle. Think about this. Mm-hmm. Like you can use your watch. I don't want to mention the name of the producer, right? To do electrocardiogram. And I like a good friend of mine, he's a doctor. Like whenever in a plane, he's called to help the other passenger. During the flight, he said like, I'm taking out my watch, right? And I'm doing electrocardiogram to eliminate, you know, any like problems in terms of the heart disease, like or strokes. Imagine though, this is like a miracle. Like,
yeah.
Like 20 years ago, you wouldn't like, you need like the plane will land, like the emergency will take you to the hospital, right? In the emergency room, and they will do electrocardiogram. And it's like 2 hours at least. Like 2 hours for someone who has experienced a health problem is like really detrimental. If this is something related to like, you know, stroke or like in the heart disease area, like your like probability for you to survive is just below 50%. Mm-hmm. Imagine that. Okay, so I'm going ahead of myself. So Internet of Body is the way forward. Like, and then we had it already, like Internet of Things with our cars. Like our cars will tell you like, well, you have a problem here. Here's a problem here, problem with the tire. If we can do it for our cars, we can do it for ourselves. This is very simple mental model. Like pills, like definition of the drug will change, and it's changing already. We invested in a company and what they produce like a special cellular capsule. Like it's still the size of drug, right? And it looks like a pill, but what it can do through a special membrane, it can release certain substance, whatever substance you need on regular basis. If you're on regular medication through the walls of this membrane. So this capsule usually replaces 3 to 6 months supplementation, right? So people have like boxes, literally like higher than they themselves for like 1 month. And all of them can be replaced by this small capsule. So we redefine, or, you know, I've seen the pill, which has a small sensor and a information exchange mechanism. So it's actually, you can scan it similar to what you do with continuous glucose monitor. And it says like, when you need to replace, we need to swallow the next pill, right? And it's released the substance, right? Wow. This is just, so many things happen. I've seen like, small capsule, which replacing gastroscopy and colonoscopy, you just swallow it. And it's this wonderful thing that just goes through your tract here, right? Making photos, videos, and analysis of your cancer risk. But like, what is more important? This small thing have like 4 engines there. 4 engines. It's like a, you know, like a spaceship.
How?
Okay, so yeah.
How? Are you saying that this is currently...
Yeah.
In practice or something, yeah, which you
this currently... This is currently in development. Yeah, this is currently in development. And it's going to hit the market in the next 5, 10, 15 years.
So this is... Right. How is that even... Okay, I understand about even maybe liposomal delivery. That's quite interesting. But this sounds completely different. It's like next level. How is that even possible?
Like, yeah, it's possible. Like, well, think about this. So you and I can talk today, right? Mm. I'm in Moscow for 2 days before I'm flying to Boston, right? You are in UK. We see each other. We talk to each other. Like 30 years ago, it was just not possible. You can read in the book and like people say, well, this is sci-fi, right? It's never gonna happen. No, it happens, right? So, and again, it's 30 years. 30 years ago, it took United States 13 years and $3 billion, of the value of 30 years. Yeah, to sequence human genome. Once human genome, 13 years. Right now, it's just a few hundred dollars and few hours to sequence human genome. Imagine that. Yeah, just exponential growth of computing power and technological power for all humanity. So like, why people think this is crazy? Because they're looking at the current version of healthcare and they're just trying to think like in the current version of healthcare, this is all impossible. Of course, it's impossible. It's going to be different. Yeah, it's going to be, again, data-driven, technology-based version of healthcare. And this is why the largest healthcare companies of the future might not be the companies that we know today, like hospital chains or insurance companies or big pharma. It might be big tech like Apple, Amazon, Microsoft. I'm not so saying this is good or bad, okay? There's a lot of regulatory and ethical questions. But the change in healthcare will come not from the direction that you know today. It's going to be new players doing completely new things.
Yeah, definitely something which needs to be innovative. I don't know. Yeah, it's wow. It's wild, but it sounds exciting as well. There may be a few skeptics, even when we look at something as simple as a vaccination. You have many that are, I don't know if they are, it's a bit of a dogmatic approach to say that if you don't want to have the vaccination, then you are anti-vax. Whereas there's people who are just like, generally, I don't like vaccinations.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. Human biology is so complex. Like, we don't actually know like how this whole thing works. What is the potential side effect? What is potential side effect? So I'm really sympathetic about people who like, who don't want to make this choice today. Let me put it this way. But like my personal story, I was against that as well until I spent 20 days in last December, December 2022, with the fever, suffering from COVID, 20 days in a row. So like, and you know what? In the course of these 20 days, I became the biggest supporter of vaccination. Again, it was not the case for me before that. Yeah, but my personal experience, and I was like, I was just, all you do is like waiting, trying to balance the risk and reward, right? And I've seen what risk means in my case. So it was like 49 years, I really suffered a lot from COVID. So that actually like pushed me into the vaccination territory.
What's your thoughts on natural immunity? Do you think that, you know, having COVID is enough? Like, okay, now I'm...
Yeah, so a number of things. And I'm going in the territory, which is not mine, right? So I'm not, you know, the academic or medical doctor. Well, first of all, let's talk about natural immunity. So the organ called thymus, which is right here, okay, inside our body, which is responsible for our immunity. What is happening? By the age of 18 or 20, it starts to shrink. Your level, well, that's actually explain like, and this is where your level of immunity starts to decline. So like, you know, every month and year, right? Thymus is shrinking and you have less gonna immune cells inside your body. That's why you becoming, it's just more risky for you. Like with every year, especially when aging starts inside your body, you're running the higher risk of dying from this killer monster disease, from this age-related disease. So like, do we have certain level of immunity inside our body? Yes. Is it really progressing? Well, it's decreasing with every year after you turn 18 or 20, okay? So that's the case. And by the way, this company called Legenesis, remember I told you the story that regenerating liver, the next program is with thymus, because if we will be able to regenerate thymus, right, then our level of immunity going to be in, you know, a completely different level, right? We're going to increase that. So that's kind of one thing. So second thing, in some of the cases, natural immunity works. In some of the cases, in the history of humanity, we paid a kind of huge price for that. Like for the herd immunity to develop itself, like in some of the moments in the history, like 20 to 30% of population has died. Okay. So like for some of the diseases, it's kind of easier. For some of the diseases or viruses, it's very difficult. And my final thought, like everything which is happening with COVID is really unusual. So I'm still undecided whether this virus has like a human influence or it's been like developed by Mother Nature. So therefore, like we're just trying to respond with our usual mental model, or I know what virus is. It's like a flu, right, or something. It's okay, you know, I can survive without vaccine. Sometimes, yeah, Mother Nature is more complex and unusual than our kind of stereotype and our kind of mental program that we have ready for that.
Mm. Have you had a biological age test? Like, was it Steve Horvath?
So it's called epigenetic clocks, biological clocks. Yeah, there are a number of biological clocks that we have today. So like biologically, I'm 43. So I'm 49 chronologically, I'm 43 biologically. There's another age that we all need to define called our psychological age. So my psychological age of 35 years. If you feel like you're 35, you're never going to be looking like you are 49. Okay.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And like, remember that I shared with all of you guys my like a fourth age, which is my target age. Like my target age is like 25. And I know it's crazy, like for 49 years old, but like, every time you think about this, even if I will not reach my kind of 25, I'm becoming younger anyway, right? My body thinks I'm 25, so I can do a lot of different things. I'm full of energy and plans. Well,
yeah, are there tests for psychological age?
No, it's a simple questionnaire. You can Google that. But like in the end of the day, like the main question is like, you know, when you think about your age, what kind of, you know, figure comes to your mind? But there's a strong correlation. If people, like for some of the people, they think they are older than they are, and it's usually statistically it's against your longevity and it shortens your lifespan.
It's a tough one sometimes because we as humans, we kind of respond to how our body is responding, and then we kind of I don't know, we capture that and log it away as this is the future kind of thing.
Yeah, I agree. So there's like one school of thought says, well, Sergey, this is all great, but its relationship between is the opposite. It's because you're so old on a biological level, your body push you to think that you're older than you are. That's fair assumption, yeah? I don't know the truth. And like, look, we've been genetically lucky because like 50% of your level of optimism and your level of happiness is genetically predisposed. So I'm like lucky one, right? I'm always been like the most positive guy in the room. Okay. And with some of the people, it's not that easy, like for me. So I totally respect that.
Sorry. You said 15? You can have a genetic predisposition of positive thinking.
Of course. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So like, I don't know. I have this book here. Yeah. It's called The Happiness Hypothesis from Jonathan Haidt. Yeah. It's kind of a cool book. It's a review of all theories of happiness. And one of the theory, like 50% of your level of happiness is like just genetically predisposed.
That's really interesting.
It is.
I got a book called The Happiness Advantage, which is by a guy called Sean Acor.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't talk about genetic predisposition, but he does just talk about how to create a happy environment. It's a really cool book. Really cool book.
Yeah, check it out if you get it. That's a great idea.
Yeah. Rapamycin, what could you tell me about that?
So rapamycin is immunosuppressant drug. So what is happening is like when someone had a transplant. So transplant is always, it's like foreign organ inside your body. And your body thinks, because it's foreign organ, your body needs to reject that, okay?
Hmm.
So, well, that's your immune system is just trying to kill this foreign organ inside your body. So it's usually the part of any transplantation kind of surgery is to treat people with immune suppressant drugs to fight your immune system, for your immune system not to kill this foreign body. So right. Therefore, rapamycin is just this kind of the drugs that's used for organ transplantation. That's why it can not only be like, you know, positive, it can be dangerous. And like, I was just like, you sent me this question yesterday, and I was just looking at the side effects of rapamycin on humans. Side effects, and this is I don't want to read the whole list, but like this is just a short like my hit list on that. Like diarrhea, 35% chances, vomiting up to 25% chances, anemia up to 33% chances, respiratory infection up to 26% chances. So like, would you want to take this risk? Today, I don't know. It might easily be the case that metformin, this generic diabetes drug, or rapamycin are a longevity drug. Easily. I totally accept that. But like, we need to test them as longevity drug. It usually means you have like hundreds or thousands of people on the trial, and you do a comprehensive assessment of the positive like and the negative effects, like side effects of this drug on your longevity and all other health aspects. So that's like responsible way to build a view whether it's going to be one of the longevity drugs for the future.
Yeah. So you mentioned a respiratory tract issue or infection.
My English is not my first language, so I apologize. It's respiratory tract infection. Well, because what is happening, you're like the level of your immune system is just going down.
Yeah.
To rapamycin, right?
Right. That's I don't, how does it even fall into a category of longevity?
I don't know. Like I can understand why metformin can fall in a category of longevity drugs. And again, I'm not prescribing metformin. I'm not taking metformin at my 49. So, because it's obviously regulate the level of glucose in your blood. And it's like, I'm almost like 100% sure it does have like effect on your longevity. Okay, and your healthy living. It's a very old drug. I think it's 50 or 60 years old. And it has certain side effects, but they are not that massive in comparison to rapamycin. It's very easy to administer. A very good friend of mine near Barzilai, who actually done a study on centenarians, and I mentioned him at the beginning of our conversation, amazing guy. He's planning the metformin trial in the US to test metformin as longevity drug. Funny enough, metformin for this study is cheaper than placebo pills.
Oh, wow.
Can you imagine that? This is how cheap. Yeah.
Okay.
Look, there's so many things on the horizon, guys. That's my message, my other message. You would need to stay on longevity bridge for the next 5, 10, 20 years and enjoy it this time. Take care of your health. Take responsibility for that, for so many decisions that you do. Like, use the best of the healthcare, what healthcare system can offer to you. Use the best what technology can offer to you in form of wearables or early diagnostic tools, right? Whether it's cancer or heart disease, et cetera. Change your diet, physical exercise, be a happier version, like sleep well, meditate, share more with the world than you give more to this world than you take back.
Yeah.
Like in 10, 20 years time, world going to be completely different. Think about the world 20 years ago, like year 2000. It's just completely different. And yeah, the same going to happen in the next 20 years. So that's it's a little bit like with HIV, right? One of the first strategies for people who suffer from HIV was just really like, just to slow down the disease and buy some time until the science, like, and technology will develop something against this disease. Mm. Well, it's the same with aging.
Yeah. You mentioned that agents, I can't remember, what was the term you used? Something like, it maybe at some point it might be classified as
disease,
as a disease. Yeah, yeah.
Sure. Yeah, I'm all for it, but like regulators all around the world are not necessarily supporting that. Again, just looking at statistics, like every year or so in your life after probably age of 45 or 50 would add increasing risk of you dying from age-related diseases. So we need to fight not only certain diseases on symptomatic level, but we need to look at aging and its core and focus on that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, Sergey, it's been absolutely amazing, my friend. Thank you so much for your time. I still need to go through your book. It's what I've been through so far. I'm like, this sounds like, I don't know, sci-fi, you know, but it's, you know, we're getting there already. So, thank you for your time and sharing your knowledge. Your book, Growing Young. What's the full
title? It's called The Science and Technology of Growing Young.
That's it.
It's available everywhere and book done pretty well. It's already Wall Street Journal bestseller, USA National, USA Today, which is USA bestseller, national bestseller. And what is more important, like if you order the book, you can claim an offer from SergeyYoung.com. We have a lot of free stuff there for someone who ordered the book, like access to Longevity Video Academy, which is 12 videos, 10 minutes each, when I talk about different technologies and or different routines that you can use today, and two other books for free as well. One on kids' health. I have four kids. And yeah, I do. And one about diet. Called 10 Simple Principles of a Healthy Diet.
I was going to say, those freebies, are they available for people who get the audio version as well? Yeah.
Sure. I mean, you claim it there and that's it.
Yeah. So in order to claim it, what do you need to give? Is
like,
there?
Look, it's all based on trust.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Just like, I mean, if you feel, you know, it's okay and you don't want to buy the book, you just kind of go there and, you know, put some random numbers and you get this for free.
Oh, that's so kind of you.
Yeah, like, but look, I'm not here to sell the books, right, in this world. Yeah, I want to change the world, but I do know that, you know, if someone wants to abuse the system, that's okay. Like, if someone will, like, really download this free content and change his or her life based on the free content, I'm like the happiest man on earth, okay? And he or she doesn't need to buy the book. But like, obviously, guys, you take a look at the book. It's just a lot of fun. And it's, I received overwhelmingly positive feedback on that. And it's 200 pages story about the, what we should expect in terms of longevity technology and longevity science in the next few years and what you can do today.
It's fantastic. Guys, definitely get that book. It is, it's life-changing. Absolutely. Sergey, quickly, one more thing. People can find you on Instagram.
Yes, Instagram, it's SergeyYoung200. Guess why 200 is there?
Could you look for 200?
So that's one. Second is SergeyYoung.com. You can sign up for newsletters. Like every month, we send out Some of the very simple explanation of what is happening in on scientific front, just review of some of the research for ordinary people, and I consider myself like an ordinary person. I'm not a scientist, so I'm just trying to translate it in simple words. And we have amazing success with our newsletters. Like in just in the course of a few months, we had already like 40,000 people sign up for newsletters and enjoying science translated in simple words.
That's awesome. I definitely need to sign up to that. I love your stuff. Thank you very much,
sir. Thank you, Roger. Everything you do, I mean, I think it's just amazing. What you guys doing, right, and the social media front, and you personally, is showing the inspiration, giving people the facts and information, and for people to be, you know, more informed about their own choices and being more responsible. This is great. Please continue to do so. And for everyone, stay healthy and happy.
God bless you. God bless you, sir. Thank you so much. We will speak soon.
Thank you for tuning in today's episode. Any guests which I have on the show really provide some golden nuggets and useful life-changing tips. So always feel free to check out their social media platforms or website links, which will be written in the show notes. These shows are financed by my sponsors, so your contributions are always greatly appreciated. Any clickable links with discount codes will not only provide you with the best services, but will help out the podcast too. So, thank you. If you do like the Roger Snipe Show podcasts, then why not give it a review? A 5-star would be awesome. But some great feedback on what you liked about the show or what you would have liked to hear would be helpful too. Until next time.